Greetings and welcome back to room 303 in Freshman English, and we continue now in our study on page 673 with our second of the two texts that we'll be looking at. This is a news article, an expository text that will give us some information. Now notice they got some ways to read this, and again, we're developing skill sets about how to read informational texts. The title here is Georgia School Displays iPod Ingenuity. Notice that this news article will have several features: current or breaking news, quotations from experts and other qualified sources, text written for a general audience. Notice we're told in our sidebar here on page 673, this title explains the topic of the article, that podcasts are being used as sophisticated learning tools. This comes from eSchool News staff and wire service reports from March 27, 2006. So you can see we're lecturing now in 2018. So obviously some of this information is going to be old, but let's go ahead and just read together. Thanks in part to an enterprising group of faculty who call themselves the iDreamers, Georgia College and State University's GSCU is quickly becoming a leader in using Apple Computer's near ubiquitous iPod. Ubiquitous just means that it's everywhere present. iPod to enhance education, and school officials say that their efforts are helping to retain more students. More than a third of the rural Georgia school's 300 staff members reportedly use the digital music and video players as an education or research tool. Rather than simply making class lectures available for downloading to iPods, a practice now routine at many colleges and even a few high schools, the school's educators are pushing to find more strategic uses of the device. History professor Deborah Vess asks students to download 39 films to the devices so she doesn't have to spend class time screening the movies. Psychology professor Nolan White has found a new age answer to Office Hours, a podcast of the week's most frequently asked questions. And the campus has organized a group of innovative staff and faculty to conjure up other uses for the technology. Called the iDreamers, the team bats around ideas that could turn the devices into portable yearbooks and replace campus brochures with podcasts. Quote, the more you free up your classroom for discussion, the more efficient you are, end quote, says Dorothy Leland, the school's president. After Leland and Jim Wolfgang, the school's chief information officer, began seeing iPods around campuses around campus in 2002, they decided to explore educational applications for the devices. They started by farming out 50 donated iPods to faculty who offered the best proposals. I'm on the page 674. Soon, Wolfgang's office was flooded with applications from educators suggesting new uses. Now, some 400 college-owned iPods are floating around campus, some loaned to students in certain classes, others available for checkout at libraries. Hank Edmondson, a government professor known about the campus as the Pod Father, was among the first to use iPods to supplement his course lectures. Edmondson makes lectures, language study programs, indigenous music, and thumbnail art sketches available for download to the iPods of students in a three-week study abroad program he leads. During a recent visit to the Prado in Madrid, he recorded a 20-minute lecture on the museum's artwork. Downloading that in advance will let students spend their visit to the museum exploring, not listening to Edmondson's talk. You want to pack everything in, but you've got a lot of travel time, he said. Beth said having her history students screen films on their iPods allows her to dedicate class time to discussion and analysis. Likewise, for the weekly graduate course, she teaches on historical methods. Now I can devote my whole 3 hours to Socratic dialogue, she said with a group. Although iPods can be useful tools for renewing coursework, some critics argue donning a pair of earphones is not the same as actively engaging with material in a classroom setting. By the way, notice your sidebar here. Here, an objection to using iPods as an educational environment is followed by details and support that address that objection, right? Learning is through interaction, discussion, critical questioning, and challenging of assumptions, says Donna Qualters, director of the Center for Effective Teaching at Northeastern University in Boston. These cannot be duplicated in an iPod. You have to be there to experience that learning. GCSU officials say that the school makes sure its iPod lessons supplement classroom work, not replace it. We don't have any project that repeats what's going on in the classroom, Wolfgang said. All this is value added. By the way, do point out on page 675 the possibility that you may be asked to write an explanatory text, a letter, where you'll be asked to write on this following. You've just begun posting podcasts that give additional information about a topic discussed in class. Write a letter to fellow students introducing your podcast, describe your content, and explain how to download and listen to the material. Use details and information from both texts that you just read here to compose your letter. And again, you'll want to focus on format and audience, and of course, some academic vocabulary. Well, there you go. We're again developing skill sets on how to read informational texts. Thank you.